This is the first conference that we try to organize and spread the Intermarium and Intermarium ideas, because I feel it's a lot of people in Poland, especially nationalists, are also familiar with this. And I think after this event, you will have a lot of questions about this, start to interest into this. And of course, everything is for our future. And age of convergence, maybe you heard this term, it's a grand fail term. But we're waiting for catastrophes. After this, the Western civilization will fall. And the fall of the West, I think, is a matter of time. We're facing the most threats that's coming from outside and coming especially from inside. The inside is neoliberalism. Neoliberalism just destroyed the foundations of our civilizations and put this to hordes that coming from Africa, that coming from East, and put our civilizations just being colonized by another influences like Islam, Eurasianism, or like I said before, neoliberalism. But a lot of people are thinking that the end of Western Europe it will be conquered by Islam. I don't think so. I think it will be just collapsed nations and cultures that will on this place will be established a capitalism state controlled only by demoralized and elites who just focused on the money for greed. And the Islamization, it's a matter of, it's an issue of lower classes of people that they're facing in their ghettos who will be established in the city, in the big cities. I live in Sweden now, so I'm talking about this like an example that I see. Like in other Western countries, the cities just became in one side fortresses of rich, white, liberal people who are saying that immigration and liberal values are very important. In another side, we look that there is established around this, it's established ghettos with mixed, racial mixed, ethnic mixed, and religious mixed. And in these ghettos in future, is Islam will be a religion of gangs like we can see it in Northern America, United States, that Latino gangs have the Catholicism or Christianity just for just like their gang culture. So I don't think so that Islam is a threat that conquered the Europe. Islam will be very popular in the lower classes of people who just lose the hope, lose for. Advance in their societies, and these ghettos will be in these ghettos we will face some ethnically and religious culture revolutions, but it will be just small struggles compared to this that demoralized elites just taking the rule and can manipulate a lot of people especially when these centers, this metro polis of these cities, metropolis of liberalism, like I can say, fortresses of liberalism, can be just a center of rule of people who just can say that your advance from and your escape from this ghetto will be dependent on them. So in Sweden, everybody wants to be like a white liberal elite, especially when we see at France or Germany, we can say it's the same. So what is the fall of West? The fall of West is not post-apocalyptic catastrophe. It's not a Islamization, and it's not a unit of prophets that want to slaughter every European who are not converted to Islam. It will be just a culturally, ethnically, and moral collapse that gives the power for big corporations, that gives power for capitalists, for liberals. They just taken the resources of these states and can influence to another weaker states like in Eastern Europe, because we must know that Eastern Europe countries in the European Union are more than colonies than independent states. So every state will fall under the heat of liberalism. It's a big threat in the future for every one of us. In Polish and a lot of Eastern nationalist movements, there is an opinion that if West will fall, so our competition will also disappear. I think it's wrong, because every country who will be destroyed by liberalism in our civilizations will be the bastion of this scourge for us in the future. And we must know that they are now and in the future, they have better resources, more money, and they have they are technologically advanced, and they have a lot of sources to influence our countries. Now in Poland we have this right-wing turn, but I don't think so. It will be for many years, for ages, especially when we see that leftists are just more activists. And another, it's outside treatments. It's a lot of nationalists and conservatives are influenced by Eurasianism ideas. I know it was very popular when we had so much alternatives, and a lot of people look at Russia, at Dugin, like it's a last hope of Europe. But we must know that Eurasianism, it's a totally different civilization than Latin European. It's created on Mongolian steppes, not in European, not in Rome, not even in Byzantium, I suppose. Of course, a lot of people just said it's a Byzantine civilization, but I don't do this. It's another threat that this threat has. And now, just try to attack one of the independent countries in Europe, and have a lot of resources, and it's very good in influencing the conservative and national revolutionary movements in Europe. And this Putinophilia can be it's another threat for us. But so it's smiling. It's another threat for us that we just thinking that something good, that it's something alternative, but it's just another imperialism that we must face. Demoliberalism is United States imperative before, now European Union, because United States start to change mentality in a metapolitical way. But now this role of spreading the demoliberalism taken just by Germany and France, and the same with Everett Gattin, but still it's dangerous, especially with Poles. Must know what is the Eurasian, Russian, Ruski Mir ideology. It has nothing with some idea, it has nothing in common with something that we should build our foundations. It just built on the interests of the people in power. Nothing more. The last threat, I think it's grown to the bigger threat in our propaganda, it's Islam. But I don't think so, it's the most problem. Of course, the most problem is with ethnically mixing and demography, that they just breeding more than Europeans and they establish on their identity, on the ethnicity mostly, but not in the religion. Islam is now and will be, like I said before, religion of lower classes. The problem with them is that we're facing something like the people, like the generations, past generations who come to Europe, they were assimilated. But their children and the next generations facing something like identity crisis. And it's mostly growth not on religious, not on a cultural way, because their parents were totally converted or assimilated. It just growth on an ethnic way. And they auto-identify them by ethnicity. And breeding with themselves, growing more than European people and creating a state inside the states, like we have this local zones in Sweden, some districts in French or some districts in Germany, but they even can say that it's not a part of Germany, it's not a part of Europe, it's part of their country. And it's nothing, it's have nothing common to the Islam, because they most of these gangsters, because most of them are gangsters, aren't Muslims, aren't even Muslims, I said, that they are so fanatics or something like this. No. Sometimes they are Muslims, sometimes they are Christians, but most of them just think that they are not Europeans and they don't want Europeans in their lives. And I want to say why we must start to thinking in a way that we should fight together about our future. Of course, 70 and 100 years ago, nationalism was correlated well with Darwinism and with social Darwinism, that every nation must compete with every nation. But we live now in a globalized world, globalized by technology, globalized by information, and we cannot say that we can't say that have nothing in common with our future, and we can still be fully independent. Of course, I'm not saying that we should create some euro state like European Union, because it's a state like for some elites, like for Russia is for oligarchs, the same European Union is for financial elites. No, with our project here, and most of the people who are invited here are familiar with intermarium ideas, and of course, it's our dream, but we must know that we have historical foundations to make it. especially first Polish Lithuanian Respublika, I know that it was a big mistake that Ukraine cannot want to join, but the history struggles and winds just blow like they blow, and we cannot do nothing now. And next, Józef Piłsudski wants to establish this again, but I think history, something happens. But, again, we just cannot do it. But now the tides is changing, and I have hope, our ideas are growing up, and we can defeat the emotional, and we can defeat the sentimental struggles that still are block our way to create something that will be competition for old imperialism in Europe, and it will be the true idea of European imperium. Because the countries in Eastern Europe are still based on our European values that Western lost. We must unite against the neoliberalism that now is flowing from Germany, from France. This is another part of imperialism. We are communists. We must revolt against the metropolis. Another thing that our region is still threatened by Russia. It's not just unrealistic idea that Russia don't want to fight with us, don't want to start the war. Of course, maybe they are now they are weak, but we know that every empire is going stronger. Wants to expect, and we must prepare for this. Maybe not in our generation, but in for the past generations. We're not living for nowadays, but we're living for our future, the future of our children. And that's why we must look more to the future than to the past. In this last, in Central Europe, was very bloody, was terrible, was horrible, of course. I remember this, I'm also a historian, I'm a nationalist, I cannot forget that my nation suffered or something. I never forget, but I know that it can be suffered more in the future, especially with this future wars, with this technology, with tools to spread death, not only in death by physical death, but the mental death of our nations. What this technology, what this plans, the threatened ideas like imperialism can do with us in future. Especially, I saw it in the West. I saw the society of sheep. Will be probably slaughtered by wolves. They just let in inside. So that's why we, of course, it's only introduction. It's not my the speakers will tell us something about more about ideas about the foundations of Intermarium, and I'm glad that I can invite them here. I'm glad that. And of course, persons who will help me with this. I'm very glad, guys, to help with this first conference in Poland. Probably we try to make it more. And I want to familiar with you with some identitarian ideas that will be connected with nationalism. Something like this, I think we can. Develop here in Poland, especially with nationalist ideas and our history, like fighting for there and our freedom. Now maybe it will have more sense than before. I think here in Central Europe we can develop something new, something that can, of course, in Ukraine they start to name it European Reconquista from the East, and I think will be part of it in the future. So now I want to introduce the next speaker, Ruben Kaleb from Estonia, who will speak about the ethnofuturistic ideas and ethnicity in future Europe and especially in intermarine zone. Next will be Konstantin Purpur from Latvia, speak about military frontiers of intermarine. Next we have Leo Marić from Croatia, that he will speak about economic ways European wage union in the intermarine concept. Next we will face a break and meet and do an outdoor meeting with book who now this book is a guide for identitarian ideas in Europe. It's good for a start with this, and I think a lot of Polish people, nationalists, are not so familiar with identitarian or with alt-right. So Daniel Friedberg will talk about this, about his book, and so this book is released. So today is the first day that it's released in Polish. Next, Mariusz Matej will talk about economy in intermarine also. And at the end, a member of Azov and National Corps, Vlad Kovalchuk, will talk about he must switch the whole energy, she cannot reach our conference, unfortunately. And
post-war left-liberal order and
Yes, post-war liberal order and European Reconquista. So I think you will enjoy this and have a lot of questions for our speakers and of course invite you to the discussion, and sorry for my bad English.
West truly is dead. France and England and Germany and America and Sweden have become just labels on a map. The European Union is European just in geographic terms. Europe has long ago become a global civilization of money and human rights. That it is a tragedy that the disguise of technological advancement has allowed the West to hide the death of its culture for so long. For technology and science has not brought us a new era and a new civilization as was once promised. It has only prolonged the agony of the same old Europe. And what if I told you that the Western culture is not superior? I have been called many things for expressing my views. A racist, xenophobe, anti-Semite, Nazi, white supremacist. But what I am not is a Western supremacist. In fact, I believe that Western culture is inferior. It is inferior to that of the savage tribes, inferior to hunter-gatherers in a rainforest with an IQ of 60. Why is that? Because the Western culture has led to denial of our tribal nature. The tribal nature that exists everywhere else in the world. For the tribal nature is based on being and not abstract values. It is based on the man's connection to his soil, connection to his ancestors, connection to his kin. It is based on the essence and what is inside us. While the Western culture has no essence and only the form. And the Western man has no connection to anything in this world. This is why the Western man does not love life and is always afraid of death. The West represents the old Europe. It has been running for 2,000 years on the energy of the late Roman Empire, and that energy is now exhausted. Since the Roman time, there has been not much new in Europe. Since then, the track of the Western culture has seen no beginnings, but only ends. We are simply witnessing their own dying again and again. Liberalism might be the most degenerate expression of the Western culture, for we still have the Crusades, but now they are waged on the name of democracy and human rights. The very European faith in progress is being used to lead us away from our roots. Everything that is destroying Europe really was hidden in the Western cultural programming already 2,000 years ago. The most destructive asset of the Western culture is its identification not as tribes, not as nations, but as abstract humanity. And the West has no essence because abstract humanity means nothing. Our biological classification as a species entails no identity, no common beliefs, no connection to each other. We are not, and never have been, merely humans. But Western culture is not the same as European culture. The creative energy of the Roman civilization has been exhausted. But that has never been the sole source of energy for Europe. For we here are mostly descendants of people who never were part of Rome. And the creative energy of our ancestors has not run empty. In fact, it is the opposite. The civilized part of Europe has created a shell around its barbarian core, but on the inside, we are not people of the great cities. We here remain people of the forests and the mountains and the seas, people of the uncontrollable forces of nature. In the inside, we are still who our ancestors were. The Vikings, the Cossacks, the Hussars, or the Viberic shamans. The Western civilization is a shell built around our essence in order to hide our true self. And this has become an empty shell, being disconnected from our roots and our essence. It tried to survive without essence and could not manage. The West is going down and the West is dead. And all its late forms, the liberalism, the leftist, the human rights ideology, are going down too. They could not possibly keep alive the illusion that they had meaning, for they separated themselves from everything with a meaning. The old world is wrecked. But there might be a silver lining to this. We might have a chance now to become who we are. The young Europe exists besides the old one. And it exists here in Poland, in Ukraine, in the Baltics. But most importantly, it exists here within us. There is light in the darkness. And we are marching towards the sunset with our hearts full of hope, for it is not sunset but dawn that awaits us. It is crucial for us to build a young Europe here between the Baltic and the Black Seas. It is the only place where this could possibly happen. The burden of saving Europe and the white race has suddenly fallen on us. If not here, then nowhere, and if not us, then no one. The young Europe is an ethno-futuristic Europe. Ethno-futurists understand that there is a deep connection between our roots and our wings. If we are destined one day to go to the stars, then it will be our connection to our ancestors that carries us. For our journey is not just a journey for organisms and species, but our spirits. And so ethnofuturism places our ethnicity at the center of everything. It is ethnicity that has meaning, and not humanity or some abstract values. This is where we begin from. This is why old Europe failed, and the young Europe can take its place. We have roots, and we have meaning. So, let us create an ethno-futuristic intermarium. Let us join forces against our enemies. Keep in mind that our enemies in both the East and the West are aware of our combined strength, and they will do everything to keep us divided. Those who fuel conflicts between Poles and Ukrainians, between Hungarians and Romanians, between Croats and Serbs, are also our enemies. But if we understand this, we can work together and we can defeat our enemies. Let us bear witness to the coming together of our great European nations. Let the world see how we come together and stand up for our identity, and stand up for our past, and stand up for our future. Let the world watch in awe as the intermarium rises. Let Moscow, Brussels, and Washington fear us. Let no one stop us. Let no barrier stand between us and the future. Except the barrier we raise ourselves to shield us from the dark forces of invaders. Long live the intermarium!
Now we listen to Konstantin Kurbus from Latvia.
Well said, Ruben, about our ancestors, about the nations. We'll keep them alive. Despite all these threats and danger from world. Well, first of all, good afternoon, friends and comrades. I would like to thank all of you for giving me and the rest of us this opportunity to come over to your beautiful country, Poland, and this opportunity to have some few words in regards of our common problems and threats and our future, perhaps. In few words, I'd like to introduce myself to all of you. My name is Konstantinas Kukors. Originally, I'm from Latvia. I was born in Riga. I belong to this old generation of guys who've been really fighting the, some people calling us the freedom fighters, resistance movement people. So I belong to this category. Back in the 1980s, I was a member of the clandestine underground in the beginning of group. We fought against the communists and we fought for our freedom, for our country, you know, for independence, and against Bolsheviks, communists, same shit. So, after several arrests, one part of us been deported from the country. They took away our citizenship and expelled from the from Latvia. Latvia at that time was part of the occupied territory by the USSR. So in the 80s, I came to Europe. And I stayed in West Europe for a couple of years, and pretty soon I realized, I began to, well, I was the youngest one at that time, a member of the resistance, and not experienced, and therefore probably I didn't know about those, too much about those threats from the West, and what it's all about. But when I arrived to West Europe, in a way I kind of idealized. You know, for us, the first enemy back then was the Bolshevik, the communist regime, and the issue of our, the occupation of our country. So we've been struggling to restore our independence and get rid of communists. And when I came to the West, I realized that, you know, probably we'll have a lot of things to do, you know, later on after the collapse of the communist system. However, in the 80s, I knew that less likely I'll be able to return. We didn't expect, you know, the collapse of the communist system in our East Europe, you know, so far, so quick. And I immigrated to the United States, and basically I grew up there and served, went to schools and served in the military. I was in Iraq and Korea and other places. And a few years ago, when I got off from the military, you know, I was stationed in Germany. I decided it's time for me, you know, to go back to my country of my ancestors and continue the fight, you know. Yeah, the fight is not over, and now we're facing, you know, the big, actually, in my humble opinion, the bigger danger. How to explain that, you know, Mark, from my own experience, you know, fighting the communists back then, it was, in a way, yeah, it was a big danger, you know. You could take your the safety and human life of your relatives and yourself, but the communists, they were obvious, you know, touchable, if we can say that. You could have seen them, you could have touched them, and you knew your enemy for sure, who is he, who, against whom you're supposed to. But nowadays, today, our enemy is so sophisticated, and sometimes you don't know who is your friend, who is your enemy. I'm talking about a liberal system, which is coming from the West, and with the collapse of the communist system, they began to pollute, if you can say that, you know, our world, our East European world, this enemy, it's much dangerous and much more dangerous. And if the communists could take away your body, could destroy your body, they could kill your soul or your heart. But the liberal system destroying your soul, step by step, year by year. And that's why I'm here. That's why I stayed in Europe, in Latvia, in my country, my ancestors. Shortly after, I joined the Party of National Alliance. So now I'm a member of Latvian National Alliance, and hopefully I'll be around, you know, still alive when we see the big change in Europe in a positive way. Now I would proceed with my presentation in regards to Intermarium and the current geopolitical situation in European Union has given us, particularly to the people of Southeast Europe, much to think about. Mass Muslim immigration, which is spinning out of control. Terrorism on European soil, which is in practice is not possible to stop. Huge economic gap and difference in standards of life between the country members of the European Union, which led to mass migration of these South Europeans to economically well-to-do West Europe. Decline of moral values and national traditions of East Europeans as a result of destructive liberalism and so-called political correctness policies of the West. Rise of Russia's imperial ambitions, the Brexit and upcoming elections in France, all these factors creating the situation that it's a right time for all of us to reflect, especially of our national and international security, on a project of Intermarium. In fact, the concept of Intermarium, back in 1920s, first time and most loudly, was propagated by Polish Marshal and Chief of State Joseph Pilsudski. At the same time, in Latvia, the first proponent of this idea was General Peteris Radzic. Emphasize the nation's will as the most important factor in foreign affairs in order to establish such an alliance as Intermarium. According to General Peteris Radzic, the treaty or convention signed by governments and ratified by parliaments cannot yet create alliance. It will exist only on the paper, and its fulfillment would not be secure. Every nationally minded citizen of the Baltic countries must be sure that the interests of the countries are closely related, that the enemy who endangers one country at the same time endangers also the other one. If one of them would lose its independence, then others will as well. Only if all Baltic nations will be surely convinced of the necessity of such close alliance, That is to say that the actions against the other enemy must be done together. Only then, in case of need, all of them will act like one country and one nation. Only then our enemy will not dare to challenge our independence. End of quote. His words could be very well related to all of us, Baltics, Ukrainians, Poles, and all East Southern Europeans. The main reason behind intermarrying was mainly to oppose Russian imperialism through creation of federation of countries in Central and Eastern Europe. I'm talking about 20s, 30s. In Pilsudski's opinion, Russia was an Asian beast hiding behind a European mask. Intermarium Union, supposed to be consisted of states located from the Baltic to the Black Sea, including Estonia, Latvia, Lithuania, Poland, Belarus, Ukraine, Czech Republic, Slovakia, Hungary, and Romania. This, however, was never implemented. It was never implemented because of our own ambitions, as well as the active counteraction of Germany and Russia. Perhaps sometimes in the future, the unification of the military forces, a creation of joint military units, and the synchronization of military doctrines of the members of will be a reality within the future intermarrying union. And one of the steps, for instance, can be already established with the Polish-Ukrainian military brigade, and perhaps all Baltic states plus Ukrainian Polish units. Today, intermarrying was openly promoted by Lech Kaczynski, Polish president from 2005 to 2010. Basically, it was his main idea in his foreign policy, particularly in the area of energy cooperation regarding the Odessa border and Brody-Gdansk pipeline. After former President Kaczynski's tragic death, the idea of disappeared from the foreign politics in Poland. Recently, however, President Andrzej Duda, a member of the same conservative political party as Kaczynski, referred to the topic during the visit in Romania at the beginning of November 2015. In his speech relating to the intermarrying concept, he called for all countries of Central and Eastern Europe to stick together and speak up together. At the same time, Romanian President Klaus Iohannis, during his meeting with the heads of the Baltic states, Slovakia, Hungary, and Bulgaria, openly stated his determination to continue implementing the plan of intermarrium drafted by President Kaczynski. This year, another big event took place concerning the future formation of intermarrium alliance. On March 14, the representatives from 8 countries of Central and Eastern Europe, Hungary, Croatia, Poland, Slovakia, Romania, Bulgaria, Latvia, and Estonia, launched a European Citizens Committee initiative for a wage union. The meeting of the representatives and the signing of the initiative took place in Budapest. The project was launched by the Hungarian Nationalist Party, Jobbik. The objective to achieve that equal wages for equal work become a fundamental principle of the European Union. No project of this magnitude, bringing together so many East European countries, had taken place until now. The initiative was not only about wages, but also about establishing a new solidarity-based European Union where countries of Central and Eastern Europe would also feel at home. It focused on the future of Europe. The president of the European Citizens Committee, Martin Gyorgyazi, Hungarian National MP of Jobbik, said the time has come so that in the place of our governments, which refuse to or unable to assume that task within the European Union, we draw attention to this topic and say that we want justice and fairness. End of quote. The countries of Central and Eastern Europe share a common destiny, in particular since 1990. They got rid of themselves of communism, and with a big hope joined the West Europe. By joining the West and the European Union, they hoped to reduce the differences in living standards. However, this did not happen because the economic policy of the West did not seek to close the gaps, but to dig them even deeper. This shame is also the fault of the national East European political elites and governments. Instead of bringing these problems to the attention of the European Union, they predominantly have been preoccupied with their own personal well-being. As a result, our economies are mostly destroyed or barely sustained in deplorable condition. The people from the countries that joined the European Union felt cheated and disappointed. In the Central Eastern region, the average wage is still way below that of the West. Every year, we East Europeans are losing thousands and thousands, mostly young, energetic, and highly skilled people who are leaving our countries to the West for economic reasons. And it's obvious that most of them will never come back. In case of Latvia alone, from 1991 till this present day, according to the official statistics, we already lost 350,000 people. It's with the original population of 2 million. Beginning from the time of Livonian Wars up to the end of the Second War, we didn't sustain such losses. We didn't lose so many people as from the time from 1991 to our days. Therefore, inequalities at European level can lead to the disintegration of the European Union, which is, in my opinion, will take place pretty soon. During the conference on March 14th in Budapest, the representatives of the participating countries signed the Declaration of the European Citizens Initiative, which says, we, the signers of this document, know that the history bound our fates together. Today we commit to a joint future too. The 20th century brought a sea of torment for our nations. In the 21st century, we are fully determined to join our forces and lay the foundations of peace, justice, security, and prosperity for all of us. End of quote. This signed declaration has the importance of the historical proportions. It marked the beginning of a civil strife at the European level. It's marked the beginning of the way to the political union called Intermarium. One should ask here the very legitimate question: will this project succeed with the European Union? Technically, the newly established Citizens Committee should submit the petition to the European Commission. Then the Commission should make a decision on a petition as soon as possible, so that the process of collecting the 1 million signatures of support for integrating the equal wages for equal work principle into the fundamental treaties of the European Union could begin. Of course, we're not naive, hoping that the European Union globalists, integrators, and liberals will put the legislation that would lead to harmonization or equalization of wages between the West and the East Europeans. However, the absence of this legislation also will hurt the West Europe, which continues to suffer from the constant social dumping. Also, the European Commission will have to explain its refusal, and not only to explain that, but justify somehow as well. And what their choice of justification will be. Ultimately, continuing huge social and economic gap between the members of the EU finally will lead to disintegration of that establishment we all know now as the European Union. And finally, the rejection of this petition by European Union leaders will be a clear indication for EU East European member states, all the way from the Adriatic to the Baltic and the Black Sea, that we must join our forces together in order to come up with a new intermarine union, the union which leadership will be free of all sorts of liberals, globalists and welcomists. The union which will be based on national traditions and national values of each and every country. The union where the economic, political and the military relationships will be built on a basis of equality, justice and mutual respect. Thank you for your attention.
Next speaker will be Leo Maric from Croatia.
Okay, I gave to myself an unpleasant task today. I know there is here in the audience as well as among us nationalists in Central Eastern Europe, a lot of people who believe in this European unity, common struggle in Europe, and so on. Those are legitimate beliefs, of course, but I think there is no real ground for them, so I will today try to prove that here. To start, let's remember what was the main goal, main motive when we were going through the process of joining the European Union. For some of us it was not so recent past, for example Poland, but for some of us like us in Croatia it was very recent. We joined the European Union only 4 years ago. So this motive was simply economic prosperity, nothing else. This European dream, so-called European dream, was consisting of promise of higher wages for our workers, of the promise that we will take part, some part, in the last belt of the Western Europe. However, after we joined the European Union, this process went in another direction. I do not deny that the standard of living improved in our countries, it's a fact, but on the other side, we witnessed a few very negative impacts of the European Union. The figures, the most important is of course the labor migration from Eastern Europe to Western Europe that occurred in the last 10-15 years. these figures we are talking about are really disastrous. For example, first I will mention the Polish example. According to some analysis, the stock of Polish citizens working in Western Europe at its peak in 2007 was 2.3 million people. It was 6.6% of total population of Poland. The Latvian population decreased 13% between 2000 and 2011. Similarly, the Bulgarian population decreased by 7% between the same years. In my country, in Croatia, there is no concrete numbers yet, but according to some researches, in the last 4 years, 150,000 people left Croatia. It's 3% of population in only 4 years. So the main reason for this demographic decline in our region is labor migration to Western Europe. And what is important, unlike previous migrations, firstly, which those previous migrations are also temporary, these migrations are permanent. These people stay in Western Europe and they don't go back to our countries, to their homelands. Secondly, those are younger people, not older people like in previous migrations. And thirdly, more of them is with the university degrees. So not those are high school workers. With these migrations, we get a bunch of other problems as a consequence. Our population is aging quickly, and that opens a question of the sustainability of the social system and concretely pension system. Our economies lose consumers, our states lose taxpayers. On the other side, in Western Europe, Western European countries get most high-skilled workers whose education is paid by the budgets from our countries. So it is paid by our taxpayers and these people work in their countries. Also now they get the new taxpayers which maintain their social system sustainable. And thirdly, mass labor migration to Western Europe in some cases resulted also in reduction of wages in Western European industries, which helps their companies to be more competitive on a global market. Now let's jump to another serious consequence of joining the European Union, the economic colonization of Central Eastern Europe by Western European countries. Despite sounding like some conspiracy theorist vocabulary, it is a really precise term for what is happening here now. Western European capital cities that took the role of metropolis, they are transforming us in the mere imperial periphery in European Union. To hit that goal, they use the European Union's sets of regulations and directives as an instrument. For example, the European Commission forced quotas to Hungarian agricultural products, as well as not allowing more than 25% of European Union agricultural subsidies for Hungary and new European Union members in 2004, reaching the level of subsidies of old members only in 2013, 10 years after joining the European Union. They seriously harmed Hungarian agriculture, which was previously one of the strongest in Europe and the strongest in Eastern Europe. When Croatia was negotiating European Union membership 3 years ago, Great Britain and Netherlands openly conditioned their ratification of the association agreement with the demand that Croatia sells state-owned shipyards. Is it needed to say which countries, which maritime countries with strong shipyard industry would profit from this? One more example. In Slovenia, European Commission tried to stop Slovenian beer company Laško to buy another Slovenian beer company Unia, arguing that it would result in a monopolist position of this Laško beer company. In doing that, they are helping Belgian company Intergroup to acquire this Slovenian one, which in the end didn't succeed. However, the argument of monopoly, which they use, doesn't seem to apply for Western European companies. For example, German owned Hrvatski Telekom is a monopolist of Croatian market and nobody cares about it. When talking about position of Central Eastern Europe in European Union, one cannot avoid the issue of structural funds of the European Union. So this political imagination among our peoples, those are so as some sort of instrument of wealth redistribution in Europe. In this imagination, people saw it as European Commission as some sort of institutional Robin Hood who takes money from rich states and gives it to the poor states. But in reality, it's not like this. Asked about whether Poland and Hungary should get the money from European Union structural funds if they refuse to take refugees, European Commissioner for Budget and Human Resources, German Gunther Oettinger, said, I quote, "A large part of every euro the EU gives Poland comes back to Germany. The Poles use the money to place orders with the German construction companies to buy German machines and German trucks. So net contributors such as Germany should be interested in the structural funds. From an economic perspective, Germany isn't a net contributor, but a net recipient." End of quote. Oettinger, in fact, blurts out. Let's again take one example to illustrate this case. In 2015, European Investment Bank approved 8 billion euros for projects concerning energy efficiency and renewable energy sources. Part of this money, Croatia invested in building solar panels and wind turbines. And what do you think, which European country is a world leader in renewable energy sources? Whose industry will profit from this money? Certainly not Croatia, because Croatia doesn't produce solar panels or wind turbines. The Germany is a world leader in it. So as I tried to show in this short presentation, the countries of Central Eastern Europe and the countries of Western Europe have conflicting economic interests. There are no mutual economic interests between our countries, and as such there is no space for common policies when it comes to anything of greater importance. Hopefully, the self-awareness among the nations of Intermarium and attempts at resistance against Brussels bureaucracy are more open now. One of positive projects started recently is a wage union initiative presented also by Konstantins before me. It is an initiative going under the slogan equal wages for equal work. It was started by Jobbik, Movement for Better Hungary, 2 months ago. And the final goal is not further redistribution of European money, in which there is no doubt that Western Europe will find their own interests. No, the ratio behind this initiative is behind this campaign is to raise awareness of the Eastern European countries, to raise awareness of the wage inequalities that exist between us and Western Europe, and in the same time to help our public in Central Eastern Europe to become conscious of real power relations on our continent. So.
W razie mam przyjemność zaprezentować Jana Friberga, autora książki Powrót Nowej Prawicy. Ja wiem, że prawica w naszym środowisku bierze się coraz bardziej ambiwalentnie, niestety, bądź niestety. Jednakowoż musimy wiedzieć jedno, że ta prawica, która ewoluuje na Zachodzie w tym momencie, związana z tym środowiskiem alt-right i identytarystów, jest zupełnie inna od tej, przez którą Europa umiera i przez którą zaczęliśmy, można powiedzieć, wycofywać się z postulatów i identyfikować się z prawicą, jak to wcześniej bywało w polskim nacjonalizmie. Aczkolwiek nowa prawica, identytaryści i alt-right bardzo wiele czerpią z europejskiego nacjonalizmu i takowych myślicieli, a ta książka jest jakby wprowadzeniem do tej nowej idei, która rodzi się na Zachodzie, która też dała zresztą zwycięstwo Donaldowi Trumpowi i która staje się pewnym środowiskiem prowadzącym dywersję intelektualną na zapleczu byłych chadeckich konserwatystów. W razie zapraszam Daniela.
Thank you. be able to speak to you here today. I also want to thank Milos for organizing this beginning of what I hope will be a very important series of conferences covering important topics and disseminating new ideas throughout Poland, especially, of course, and the rest of Eastern Europe. Because I do believe that there is a vital nationalist movement in Poland, and I also believe that Europeans need to increase their cooperation, and we can learn from each other, we can help each other. And as the only representative of Western civilization here today, I would also like to mention that Western civilization is more than just degeneracy and liberalism. Before the catastrophe in 1789, the French Revolution, and the birth of liberalism, we actually managed to create some of the greatest innovations, produce some of the greatest explorers in the world. So please don't judge us too harshly just because we are currently suffering from the mental illness called liberalism. And some might argue that Western Europe is on its deathbed, that it's over. And I don't completely agree. It's still an open question. It's not looking good, but there's still some hope. And I absolutely agree with this concept of intermarrying, which I think is great. And I do also agree with Ruben Kallen and many others that the Reconquista, when it happens, in full force, will come from the East, Eastern Europe. So, with that said, I would like to first of all give a brief introduction of myself, because I think many of you are not quite familiar with my work and so forth. Secondly, outline the purpose of writing this book and why it's important, why all of you should buy it. And thirdly, give a short speech explaining the core concepts of this book, which I think is new concepts for many and audience. And after this, we will have the opportunity to ask questions. I'm hoping for a lively discussion, maybe even some debates. I assume Ruben would like to say something about what I just said about Western civilization, for example. And anyways, the basic purpose of writing this book, I actually got the idea pretty much 1.5 years ago, and wrote the book in 6-7 weeks. While noticing the great amount of new people rallying to our side, much in correlation with the overall trend of the shift to the right happening all across Europe and the West as well, which we could see in the Trump phenomenon, for example. And the need to provide these newcomers, these new people coming over to our side, with a good introduction, a good basis, a good ideological foundation, a common terminology to make their efforts, to make their contributions to our struggle much more effective, which I set out to do, and I think I did a fairly good job at it, if I may say so myself. Anyways, for anyone who wants a good introduction to identitarianism, to the alt-right, to the French New Right, and also a brief historical explanation of why Western Europe is in this historical crisis it finds itself in today, this is a good starting point. And for anyone who wants to read more, there are plenty of more books expounding on those issues available through Arcus.com, for example. So I will continue with explaining some of the core concepts of the book. which may be the most important one. First of all, I'll introduce myself. Sorry for the politeness. My name is Daniel Fridberg. I'm from Sweden. I've been involved in nationalist politics for 23 years now, since I was 16 years old. And especially metapolitics, which is basically the activities, the political activities that takes place outside of the parliamentary process, which I believe is the most important ones. And I'm the founder of the world's biggest alt-right / traditionalist publishing house, Arctos, which has been around for 7 years now. We published over 150 books in 14 different languages so far, Arctos.com. I'm also the co-founder of altright.com, which is a European-American collaboration, basically. It's an American media company. If you're not familiar with the site, I recommend you to visit it. It contains a lot of very interesting material and a vast number of podcasts, including my own, which is named Eurocentric, fittingly enough. And also the founder of Metapedia, the right-wing alternative to Wikipedia, which has been co-opted by the left in most countries. And I'm also the main organizer of the conference series, Identitarian Ideas, which in purpose is similar to this one. We have our 9th installment of this conference series, the 25th of February this year, where Milos and among other people attended. And we held it in the most leftist district in Stockholm, where all the journalists and left-wing politicians live. And we managed to organize the biggest alt-right conference in the world, in the heart of Stockholm, in the belly of the beast, so to speak, among all the worst people in Sweden. But enough bragging, and let's get to the core issues. So, something I talked a lot about, and I also mentioned before, and which is kind of a central concept of this book, is metapolitics. So, what is metapolitics, you might ask? Metapolitics is basically a war of social transformation at the level of worldview, thought, and culture. Any parliamentary struggle must be preceded, legitimized, and supported by a metapolitical struggle. Metapolitics, at its best, reduces parliamentarism to a question of mere formalities. As late as the 1950s, traditional ideals were considered the norm in most of Europe. The nuclear family was regarded as the basic foundation of society, and the relatively homogeneous ethnic composition of the European nations was not seen as a problem to be solved by mass immigration. Today, more than 60 years later, the ideals of the West have been completely inverted, and ideas that originally belonged to the periphery of the extreme left have been elevated to social norms that today dominate the education sector, the media, our government institutions, and private NGOs in Western and Northern Europe. In his book, New Culture, New Right, Michael O'Meara, which is an author I can recommend to everyone to familiarize yourself with, it has written a lot of good stuff, presents the path of development that brought us to this point. One of the factors he addresses is the Frankfurt School and its concept of critical theory. Marxist sociologists and philosophers at the Frankfurt Institute für Sozialforschung in the early 20th century aimed, through their conception of philosophy and selective social analysis, to undermine confidence in traditional values and hierarchies. Its ambitions were to play an increasingly significant role in the post-war period. Many of the Frankfurt Frederick School's ideas are prevalent in both the left's and the media's description of reality today. In a society characterized by uncontrolled immigration and related social problems, they try to convince their populations that the crucial factor is Western racism. The concepts of a right birth control and radical feminism seem tailor-made to maximize the selfishness of both genders, as well as to reduce the number of births to well below replacement level, something we can see with the results of today in most of Europe. Patriarchy and traditional genderisms are regarded as if they were harmful concepts in public debate. Mass immigration, sexual liberalism, and many other negative political and cultural choices cannot be fully explained by the activities of the leftist politicians alone. Without the Frankfurt School and similar projects, it is unlikely, if not inconceivable, that they would have taken the shapes they did. In order to understand how one of history's greatest civilizations, in what could be seen as a brief moment of history, in terms of historical time, has undergone a drastic transformation from a life-affirming society to a genuinely self-destructive society, one needs an understanding of the role of metapolitics in the social upheavals of the latter part of the 20th century. The concept of metapolitics was developed by the Italian communist Antonio Gramsci in his quest to analyze the reasons behind the fact that the communist revolution never succeeded in Western Europe. According to Gramsci, this was because the bourgeois cultural hegemony had to be broken first in order to make society receptive to the idea of a communist takeover. Guided by this analysis, the left later began what the German leftists termed their long march through the institutions, and finally secured leftist cultural hegemony in Western Europe in particular. That was achieved through a long-term, persistent and uncompromising meta-policy. Neither political violence nor parliamentary politics played a major role in this process, even if it came to influence both. Meta-politics can be defined as the process of disseminating and anchoring a particular set of cultural ideas, attitudes and values in a society, which eventually leads to a deeper political change. This work need not, and perhaps should not, be linked to a particular party or program. The point is ultimately to redefine the conditions under which politics is conceived, which the European cultural left pushed to its extreme. The metapolitical chokehold that political correctness has over Western Europe is a result of consistent cultivation, or rather misuse of this strategy. Only by understanding this tool, countering its misuse, and turning it to serve our own ends can we overcome the miserable situation that our continent finds itself in today. Moving on to more current issues, more positive things. 2016 was an eventful year, a year marked by populist victories and globalist defeats, ranging from Brexit and Trump to the Italian referendum, as well as a Hungarian referendum on immigration, where about 93% of the population firmly said no to any migration whatsoever. 2017, the current year, is bound to continue this trend. The populist and nationalist right, or what we refer to as the true right, will continue having political victories, and the liberal globalists will suffer further defeats. It is clear that we have recently entered a new paradigm, and that the time to come will be more eventful than the years that have passed. Many of you might ask how we best make use of this momentum. What should we do next? To this question, there are some points of advice. Well, keep doing what we've already been doing. In terms of metapolitics, crush the final remnants of political correctness and keep building our own media platforms. This, since our current strategy is obviously working, let's do even more of the same, but intensify our efforts. Number two, maintain a positive attitude. Even if the streets of Western Europe might be burning from so-called cultural enrichment, remember that the liberal leftist opponents have already lost. They've just not stopped breathing yet. Keep this in mind and spread a positive, encouraging message around you to raise the morale through our ranks and potential recruits. People want to join the winning side. Show them that we are winning and we are never going to get tired of it. Number three, have large families. Feminism and the degeneracy of potential partners are not valid excuses. We are currently fighting a demographic war, at least in Western Europe, but also partially Eastern Europe, to be honest, in terms of the below replacement levels of births. And a demographic war which we have so far been losing. Let's change that and make sure that the nationalist and traditionalist Europeans are the ones who pass on their genes in the largest numbers. The leftist liberals can and should abstain from family building. It will only cleanse the European gene pool of our weaker elements who lack proper instinct, ethnic identity, loyalty and common sense. Make sure to have four children or more so that we ensure that the future Europeans are our descendants rather than those of our deranged political opponents or the people currently invading our continent. Number four, emerge from the shadows. Many of us, especially in Western Europe, have suffered under the soft totalitarianism of the PC establishment for several decades. Not so much anymore. It is fully understandable that some of you might be prevented from openly taking a stance for our ideas due to extremely sensitive career choices. If that is the case, consider changing your career in order to become more independent and less vulnerable to attacks from our opponents. And with that said, there are of course a few rare cases of individuals that can do more good by staying below the radar and working covertly from within the system. But more often than not, this is just a lame excuse to make people feel better about themselves, and the real reason is often pure cowardice. It is time to realize that the time of cowardice has come to an end. And it is time to make a stand and to challenge your enemies openly. Make sure to do that. Those who know the gravity of the situation but chose to stay passive and hidden are not much better than the very people working against us. Ask yourself, is it really a worthy life goal to spend the rest of your life accumulating wealth, working for a bank or a multinational company, while our entire civilization is going up in flames? Choose your path wisely. You, who are here today, are most likely no coward or passive bystander. And by reading my book, which, as I mentioned before, is meant as a basic introduction and orientation to the world of ideas of the European resistance of the 21st century, rising up from the ruins to save our European civilization in this alone world. And we do live in the 11th hour. And therefore, it's imperative that you do as much as you possibly can to contribute to our forthcoming inevitable victory. Disregard all the defeatist claims that it's already too late. It is never too late. Sure, our current demographic situation is less than ideal, to put it mildly. And it is most likely unavoidable that we, through low birth rates and violent ethnic conflicts, will see our European populations severely decimated during the coming decades. But that is certainly no reason to give up. The European civilization consisted of 10% of today's European population numbers, or even less, during some of its highest peaks. And as long as there are still Europeans breathing, it is always possible to rebuild. The most important thing is who is the last one standing. And I'm convinced that it will ultimately be us. There is simply no other option. With this book and other titles recommended in the reading list of them, you will get the proper ideological and strategic foundation to become a more productive member of the alternative true right and our fierce resistance to the globalist, destructive and failing agenda. Make use of this knowledge and put it into action. From resistance to reconquista, from reconquista to restoration. Let the adventure begin. Thank you.
Okay, now we can start with some questions. But I have my first question, maybe somebody who wants to before me. So, my question is, because the alt-right make a good job in metapolitics in a cultural way, in a way of alternative counterculture that they create in the internet, that they create in something that it's, I cannot call it subculture, but it's something that's coming from a bottom, not from the upside. So maybe you can tell us, because we don't have so much experience to create this, but we want to try it. How is the methods of alt-right, and you mentioned it in your book, that they try to create this counterculture movement?
Yeah, absolutely. And I do believe it's actually suitable to call it a subculture, or the embryo of a subculture at least, which is certainly something we want to create and need to create. We need to create a subculture of resistance. We've already had several different nationalist subcultures. Now it's time to create one that is actually appealing to most people. Yeah, this is something that Eastern Europe might actually learn a little bit from the West about. Because we have been successful in building alternative media platforms. That is undeniable. The American alt-right is world-leading in the so-called memes. Basically memeing Donald Trump into power, and podcasts, various media initiatives. We have everything from Breitbart to Alt-Right.com to Red Eyes, which is a very impressive media operation. And of course, Metapedia and so forth. And that is basically because we focused very much on metapolitics. And since we've been shut out from the mainstream media and the mainstream culture, we've had to create our own, we've been forced to create our own platforms. And we've been pretty good at it, if I may say so myself. And I'm not talking about things that I'm involved in personally, but I'm talking about initiatives from the West in general. Those things are important. We are basically fighting an information war right now. The real war has not started yet. So now it's still the phase where we need to win the hearts and minds of the people. And we are doing that very rapid rate, and the trend is continuing, and it's doing more than that. It's actually increasing exponentially in terms of recruits. And I mean, as an example, I've been organizing the similar conference that you are having here now, and that I hope that you will continue to have for as long as possible and make this some sort of series. In Sweden, we have Identitarian Ideas, which had, as I mentioned earlier, its 9th installment in February. The first time we were 27 people or something. Pretty much the same amount of people gathered here today. The year after, we were 90 people. After that, we became more and more for every year. And the last time, on February 25th, we were almost 400 people. Most of these were obviously new people and young people. So we are recruiting. We are winning the hearts and minds of our people in an increasingly rapid pace. And therefore, we should continue with what we are doing, because we need more popular support. So I hope that answered your question, or did I miss something?
Ktoś jeszcze ma jakieś pytania?
I have a question. As we know, Europeans are dying and immigrants take their place. But there is no any united front of nationalists in Europe. For example, the main problem of organizing such a front is historical resentment and still present chauvinism of the European nationalists. How can we fight it?
Well, I think the enemies are helping us with that, actually. The migrant crisis has been a very strong unifying factor in itself. It has made many people realize that we need to put history behind us, historical differences behind us, and work together. Because the entire European civilization, our common civilization, is in a crisis, under threat. And we need to work together to solve that, obviously. And I mean, just this latest joint statement from the Visegrad countries against migrant quotas is a sign that we are moving in that direction. So obviously we still have some issues to deal with, but I think that is progressing by itself. And because people, I mean especially nationalists, which are the ones who are most likely to hold these grudges against neighboring countries for historical wrongdoings and things like that, historical conflicts, nationalists are realizing that we have bigger issues to deal with now. We have to put our differences aside. We can deal with that later. I mean, after we've gotten rid of the colonists and driven them out of Europe, then we can go back to bickering about borders and our intra-European differences, but now is not the time, pretty much.
Thank you.
So, any more questions?
How do you see the dynamics between Eastern and Western European nationalism, and what would be the role of Intermarium in relation to the alt-right?
I do believe that, as I mentioned before, I really like the concept of Mario. I think it's a great concept. I think it's essential, basically, to save our civilization. But we should not neglect the contributions from nationalists in Western Europe. You have to give us some credit, at least. We've been fighting against overwhelming odds and still managed to do quite well. For example, that a small country like Sweden, with 7.5 million people, manages to organize the world's biggest alt-right conference, is testament to that. That we are making progress. And the French new right is also something very significance. Without the first rights, the that was started in 1968 by Alain de Benoit and a group of other intellectuals, and the ideological foundation of the French New Right, the identitarian movement would never have been born, for example. Many other movements wouldn't have been born. The alternative right also derives a lot of its ideas from the French New Right. So when it comes to the world of ideas, we have to recognize that countries like France, for example, have a lot, or have contributed a lot, and we can learn from that to make our struggle even more efficient. And we also need to realize that we need new thoughts, we need new concepts. An ideology that has failed, for example, the old ideologies of the past century, it's basically a law of nature that an ideology that has failed once can never be resurrected again. So we need to create something new. And we do that through, for example, tapping into the ideas of the new rights, the alt-right, identitarianism, and repackaging. Everything is about PR nowadays, but it also has to have an ideological core that is indeed novel. It's something new, something interesting, something appealing to young people. Young people especially are not that interested in historical ideologies and old concepts. And I think we're doing a pretty good job at that. I like your term, ethnofuturism, for example. One of my favorite terms is archaeofuturism, which was coined by the French New Right philosopher Jean Faye. And there is actually, to get back to my book again, there is a glossary of many of those terms at the end of this book, which will come in handy, because we need a common terminology, we need new terms, we need new, fresh concepts that are appealing to young people we need to recruit today. So, did that answer your question, or should I elaborate more?
Could more be done to integrate Western and Eastern European nationals?
Yes, absolutely, and I think what we're doing right now is part of that process. And especially, I've been working towards that. I mean, I currently live in Budapest. I give lectures frequently all around Hungary, collaborating with various movements in Hungary, especially their identitarian student union, which is a very promising organization with very high quality people. And that's also why I'm here today, and why I've been visiting Poland and giving speeches here before. And I do believe that ultimately we need to find a way to integrate even further, to create some sort of nationalist international, basically to coordinate our efforts more efficiently all across the European continent. And we already have some sort of different embryos towards that purpose. The identitary movement is very much something like that. I mean, they have a central committee and they have charters in at least 8 or 9 countries. But we need to take it further. We need to make it European-wide completely. And that is why conferences like this one and the one in Stockholm, where you were and Milos also participated, are so important, because networking between leading European nationalists and European nationalists in general is key towards achieving this goal. I think much more can be done, and I think much more will be done in the coming year. And I'd be happy to talk more about you
state aid and the construction movement in Europe and its relation to nationalism.
Could you repeat the first question? I didn't
hear. Your opinion on the role of Western churches, of Christian churches in Western Europe, in the current crisis, for instance, the Swedish Lutheran Church.
Yeah, that is a very relevant question. I believe that the Protestant countries in Western Europe are worse off than all other countries, basically, with the exception of France. and that is no coincidence, because Protestantism, the Reformation, the entire Reformation was a revolt against hierarchy, a revolt against tradition, a revolt against order, and which paved the way for further revolutions against traditions, against hierarchy, against norms. So I view that essentially as a very destructive thing. And the Protestant Church have very much been complicit in creating this crisis. I personally left the Swedish Church because it has turned into a radical left-wing organization. It is no longer a Christian organization. I think the head of the Swedish Church is a Jewish lesbian bishop. That kind of says it all. And we have lots of like lesbians who are priests in the Swedish Church, and they are even breaking Swedish law by hiding illegals in churches. It's the same in many other Western European countries. So I do believe that the churches in Western Europe have largely been a very destructive force. If you look at the last 50 years, at least. When it comes to your second question about the revival of paganism and its role in the nationalist resistance, did I understand that correctly?
Yes, yes.
I think it's difficult to revive a tradition that has been broken. I mean, the whole concept of tradition comes from traditio, to pass something onward to the next generation. So when a tradition is broken, it's essentially no longer a tradition. So I don't think it's possible to revive a tradition that is dead. Instead, we need to have a rebirth of it. I think that's a more proper term, if that is the path to take. If that is even something we should do when it comes to paganism. My personal opinion is that religious issues are, in essence, divisive. And what we need right now is European unity. So personally, I don't take any religious stance because I don't want to divide people. I want Europeans to unite against a common threat, which is not a religious threat, it's an ethical threat, and I believe that the thing that we all can unite around is our common ethnic, our ethno-cultural foundation of our civilization. I hope that answered your question.
Yeah, yes, thank you.
Or any further questions? Maybe me also.
Czyli nikt nie ma więcej pytań? Zresztą trochę nagle musimy się streszczać, ale chyba dalsze to jest Ragnar z Powrast. Take another speakers.